Hi guys, this is Raj and welcome back to my channel. So today's video is all about the application process for MS. I'll be explaining in detail each and every step and requirement. It's a long and complicated process, so let's get started.
Alright, so the first step is to clear the qualifying examinations. To begin with, let's speak about the GRE. The GRE is an exam which will test your skills in verbal ability, that is your knowledge of English and vocabulary, quantitative ability, that is your ability to solve mathematical problems, and AWA, which will test your writing skills. Many of the universities, rather I should say most of them, require the GRE scores. TOEFL is an exam which is completely about English. It contains four sections: reading, writing, speaking, and listening. Universities require TOEFL so that it is proved that students have the ability to study a course in English. The IELTS exam serves a similar purpose. So now we'll talk about the undergraduate degree. The most important thing to remember is that US universities accept undergraduate degrees of 4 years only. That is, you must have completed degrees such as BE, BTech or BPharm before you start your first semester of MS. So if you are pursuing a degree like BSc, BCS or any 3-year course, you might have to complete one more year of some master's degree or any other undergraduate degree before you can apply. The next step is to shortlist the universities which you want to apply to. There are thousands of universities. Each university has a number of programs and many different courses. So to identify the university which is right for you, you must go through the various programs as well as the courses. You must also know which universities are within your scope. Some universities may have specific requirements like a particular GRE score or a particular TOEFL score in speaking section. So based on various factors such as what courses are there, what faculties are teaching it, and what is the cost of study there, you should shortlist your universities based on all these factors. Alright, so the fourth step is to gather your transcripts. Now a transcript is just an official statement of marks. It may be issued either by your college or by your degree granting university. Now you need to start the transcript process well in advance because universities take up to 60 days to issue your official transcripts. So now certain universities in the US like Texas A&M University and Carnegie Mellon CMU's Heinz College, they do not accept our transcripts as they are. They require those transcripts to be evaluated according to US standards. Now this is done by a variety of companies such as WES, that is World Education Services. So you should also check whether any of the universities you are applying to needs a transcript to be evaluated, and then you need to start that process accordingly. So now the next step is to arrange your letters of recommendation. Basically, these are letters written by your faculty or ex-employers who are willing to give you a reference. An LOR typically talks about your skills, abilities, behavior, and professional mannerisms. You must identify your professors and employers who will give you a reference. Approach them and ask them if they are ready to do so. If they ask you to, then you should prepare a rough draft of the LOR and then get it approved from them. Alright, so the next step is the statement of purpose. Now your SOP is probably the most important document in your entire application. It should describe your educational background, your aims and motivations for your graduate studies. It should basically answer two questions. Why does this university interest you so much? And secondly, what's in it for the university if they accept you? So now I would always recommend you to get your SOP revised professionally for several things. Firstly, to make sure that it meets the university guidelines, that is it answers the questions that the university wants you to answer. And secondly, there should be absolutely no grammatical mistakes in your SOP. So your SOP basically will define you and be the main criteria for judgment of your application. So next, you will have to prepare your resume or CV. It should be preferably a 1 or 2 page document. It should tell you the reader about your academics, your GPA or grade point average, your achievements and your publications. Now, some universities might give a lot of weightage to a certain aspect, like, for example, your publications. In that case, you should highlight in detail about each of your publications and give a short description about each one. Other universities might, look at your projects more. So you should describe your projects in your CV. I would recommend you to make the CV in LaTeX rather than MS Word or any other software, because LaTeX gives a professional look and feel to your CV. Okay, so now you have to get ready to apply. So after you've shortlisted the universities, go to their websites and create your accounts on each website for your graduate applications. Maintain an Excel spreadsheet of the username and password. Make sure that all of your recommenders have agreed to give you a reference. And have your SOP in PDF format as well as your transcripts also in PDF format ready before you start applying. This will greatly speed up your application process. Now here comes the most important part, that is to apply online. You have to fill up lengthy questionnaires and forms about your personal details, academic history, your background, research, your work experience. You must upload the documents as and when required. And after you're done with the filling the entire form, you have to submit and pay the application fees. Now the application fees vary from university to university. They're generally between 75 to 120 US dollars. And these must be paid via credit card only. So also make sure that you have a credit card ready. Now that you're done with your applications, you have to follow up with your recommenders to make sure that they upload your letters within the prescribed time only. Many of the universities do not accept LORs after the deadline. Some of the universities, such as UCLA, will also require that you send hard copies of your transcripts, and then that after you submit your application, you get some unique ID and you have to send your transcripts to them by courier or post. Here comes the toughest part, the wait. You have to wait for the university to review your application and get back to you. Decisions are generally communicated via email by mid-March. Even if it's a reject, the university makes it a point to email you about it, and many of them also give you reasons as to why you are rejected. Some of the universities might also contact you before the decision for certain queries or for you to update certain things in your application, like your transcript PDF may not be clear. So if the university does so, you must respond to them at the earliest. And here is the final step of your application process. After the university has accepted you and you have decided upon a university, you have to apply for a student visa. You'll have to take an appointment at the embassy which is nearest to you. Now, the visa officer may ask you several questions about your plans for graduate studies, your future plans, your financial conditions, and who is sponsoring you, and so on. So once your visa gets approved, you're good to go.
Alright, so that pretty much sums it up. Please subscribe to my channel for more such videos. And if there's anything else that you want me to cover, do leave a comment in the comment box. Thank you.